Hello, I am Jason Ginetti, and I am very glad to be back here. I was here maybe 2 years ago, and then I was here maybe a year before that, or 2 years before that. I believe that my lectures here were, the first one was the Principles of World Religions, where I touched upon Eastern religions in the course of the three lectures that I gave. I think the second one that I was here for was a series specifically on Islam, if I remember correctly. And I'm very, very pleased to be back here. I remember very fondly that it was not only a very big audience, but also a very lively and inquisitive audience, and I really enjoyed that. So I leave time at the end for questions, and I'm happy to answer whatever questions you have. I just will let you know that I will repeat them just so everybody can hear, since not all of you have a microphone. This is a six-part lecture series, which is great. It really deserves that much time. And it's on religions of the East. Now there are very, very many different religions, and the East encompasses a very large swath of area. But I'm going to be focusing on three major religions and how they work together, or at least how they are in conjunction with one another, because they all bump up against each other, if not work directly with one another. The first that I'll be dealing with is Hinduism, which is debatably the most ancient of the three. The second that I'll be dealing with is Buddhism. Buddhism grew out of Hinduism, sort of the way that you could say Christianity grew out of Judaism, or you could say that Protestantism grew out of Catholicism. So Buddhism is, in some respects, an offshoot and also a reactionary religion to its milieu, which is Hinduism. Then I will be dealing with Taoism. Now, when I said that Hinduism is debatably the oldest of the three, the debate would not be with Buddhism, which came out of Hinduism historically, but rather it's very, very difficult to say how old, how ancient Taoism is, but could be as ancient as Hinduism. Taoism, unlike Hinduism, which was in India, Taoism is indigenous to China, and we'll be looking at it not only because it's very important in and of itself, but also because when Buddhism, which is a religion that grew up in India, comes into China, it comes into contact with the indigenous religion, which is Taoism, and it is, if the Taoists, and the Buddhists find very, very similar ideas in each other. And so Buddhism, in order for the native Chinese population to understand it, gets translated into many of the terms that were already used in Taoism. So they are very important for each other. In order to understand Taoism as well, we're going to be looking at Confucianism, which was also a native religion or societal order of China, and was in many ways, until Buddhism came along, the competitor with Taoism.
How do you spell Taoism?
Taoism? Well, there's two different, the question is how do you spell Taoism? There's two different transliteration systems, and one of them, the Wade Giles translation system, spells it with a T, T-A-O, but it's pronounced Dow, like the Dow Jones. The other transliteration system uses a D for its transliteration, D-A-O, Taoism. It's pronounced like a D, but the first system that transliterated the Chinese words into a Latinized script was the way Giles and they used a T. So you can see alternative spellings. So after Confucianism and Taoism, we will be looking at a development of Buddhism that took place primarily in China. And that development is a branch or an offshoot of Buddhism proper, and it's called Chan Buddhism. Now, you may be familiar with Chan Buddhism from its Japanese translation because it jumps from China to Japan, as well as other countries, and in Japan it's called Zen Buddhism. So we'll be looking at Chan Buddhism and Zen Buddhism, and then we'll be looking at a comparison between the religions of the East and the religions of the West. We'll be doing some sort of cross-cultural analysis to see what things are similar and what things are different. And finally, the last lecture will deal with America's reception of Eastern traditions, such as Hinduism, Buddhism, and Taoism. We'll be looking at some of the strands that we find in America going as far back as the New England Transcendentalists, your neighbors over in Concord, and how they received the Eastern lore and how it was received later in the next century by such people as the Beat Poets and Jack Kerouac, and also by such figures, though he's not American, but he was very key in bringing the Eastern religions to America, such as Alan Watts. We'll be looking at those figures and how Buddhism, Hinduism, and Taoism was received here in America. So that's a total of 6 lectures. Today's lecture deals exclusively with Hinduism, and I'll be starting by talking about the Vedas and the Upanishads. Now, the Vedas are the oldest written form of the Hindu tradition. The Vedas are written in Sanskrit, which is a remarkable language in and of itself because, I'll just give you a little bit of a historical background that both anthropology, archaeology, as well as the more recent uses of genetics have discovered to be the case, and then through the science of philology, the study of dead languages and the transmission of languages, has discovered some really interesting things. What we find is that there were a group of people who lived in what today we would call the Middle East, the Fertile Crescent, and that these people traveled from the Fertile Crescent down into the continent of India. And these people who traveled down into India were what are referred to as Aryans. They mixed with and also dominated the more ancient native peoples of the Indian subcontinent. And these Aryans who were in the native in the Indian subcontinent developed the Vedas. These peoples then, for whatever reasons, whether it be climate reasons or for economic reasons, we're not exactly sure, they then sprung out of the subcontinent of India back into the Middle East some 1,000 or 2,000 years later. And they traveled from what we call the Middle East today, or the Levant, they traveled from there all the way across Europe, right up and to England and Ireland. And still today, we have 2 countries whose names are derived from these ancient Aryans. The names of these countries are taken directly from the word Aryan, Does anybody know the two countries?
Ireland.
What?
Ireland, one of them.
Ireland is one.
Yeah.
And?
Wales.
And Iran. Iran and Ireland. So it's just amazing when you think about how far these Aryans traversed. Now, this is not to be confused with any sort of propaganda that was spread by the Third Reich and Hitler talking about Aryans. We're not talking about blonde-haired, blue-eyed people. Not talking about Germans. Part of the reason why that propaganda got started was because these studies, both linguistic and having to do with archaeology and anthropology, were just being developed around the 20s and the 30s, and they were discovering that this group of people known as the Aryans, which in Sanskrit means the noble ones, had traveled and conquered all of these lands sometime in the far, far distant past, maybe 4,000 or 5,000 or more years ago. They had Sanskrit as their native language. And in many respects, Sanskrit is the very, very far background language of all of the languages that are spoken in Europe. So you may have heard the expression Indo-European languages. It's Indo-European languages because Sanskrit is in the far, far distant background of the European languages that sprung up. So we can still find today connections between the European languages, not only the older ones like Latin and Greek, but even modern today languages, connections between those and Sanskrit. So for instance, the word divine is related to the Greek thea, or theos. We get the word deity from it. But it goes all the way back to Sanskrit, where the word deva means a holy being, a sacred or divine being. Deva is a Sanskrit word. And you can hear that dental d in, and it becomes a sometimes, in all those words, theos and dios and deity. So that's just one example of how Sanskrit is behind all of these Indo-European languages. Now these ancient Aryans came up with the Vedas, and the Vedas sing praises to the various gods. One of the most important gods for this ancient period, this perhaps the most ancient period we know of in writing because of the Sanskrit that was written down, is Indra. And Indra is a god of battle and of war and of domination. But then a change comes along towards the end of the Vedic period, when these ancient writings were being developed, and we have a paradigm shift that takes place in India, and we get the Upanishads, which means the closing of the Vedas. It's the ending of the Vedic literature, and the Upanishads are sacred texts that mean literally, thus I have listened, I have heard, and that has to do with sitting at the feet of some sage and hearing stories told about the Vedas. But in this transmission, there's a very distinct difference between the Vedas, which have a lot of war imagery, and the Upanishads, which in my estimation, are perhaps the oldest form of philosophy. They're very, very philosophical and oftentimes dialectical. They are sometimes written as a dialogue between teacher and student. I'm a professor of philosophy, so I'm very interested in these because the word philosophy is Greek. It wasn't applied by the Hindus to these texts, but I think you can find it to be very philosophical. And it's the Upanishads that I want to focus on the most in this lecture.
Can you spell that?
Upanishads? U-P-A-N-I-S-H-A-D-S. Upanishads. U-P-A-N-I-S-H-A-D-S. Upanishads. Sometimes you'll find it spelled without an S-H. Sometimes you'll find it spelled with an S with a dot over it, which is the transliteration form of sh into our Latinized language. But it's the Upanishads that I want to focus on, and I want to try to develop a notion of what is going on in the Upanishads. I'm going to perform a very, very gross act of condensing all of these diverse writings into something that can be perhaps partially comprehensible in the next 30 minutes. You'll see why only partially comprehensible in a moment. For the Upanishadic era, the focus is no longer on the war god, but now the focus turns to a notion of what can only be described as a concern with the one and the many. The one and the many. And so we sort of, Indra is still found in the Upanishadic texts, but Indra is sort of a minor figure at this point. What becomes extremely important is a trinity of gods, and that trinity is Brahma, B-R-A-H-M-A, Vishnu, V-I-S-H-N-U, and sometimes, like I said, you'll see it transliterated with just an S instead of the S-H, the S with the down over. And so you have Brahma, Vishnu, Gesundheit.
Sorry.
That's right, nothing to sneeze about. Brahma, Vishnu, and then the third deity is the name has just suddenly escaped. Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. Thank you. Help from the audience. It's always good. I'm just shocked looking out here at how many people are taking notes. My college classes don't take notes like this. I'm actually a little worried right now because, Chris, am I supposed to come prepared with a test for them next week? So, we have Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. You were trying to tell me that with the sneeze. Shiva! And these three work very logically together. Brahma is the god of creation. Vishnu is the god of preservation. And Shiva is the god of destruction. So you sort of have a beginning, middle, and end right there in these three gods. Brahma, creation, Vishnu, preservation, Shiva, destruction. What is it that they create, preserve, and destroy? Universes. So this is one of our key terms in Hinduism. In Hinduism, there's a belief in the circular motion of time and existence, otherwise known as reincarnation. So not only are souls reincarnated, but the entire universe goes through a process of being born, of being preserved for some time, and then being destroyed. Now, the period of preservation by Vishnu is a vast amount of time, some millions upon millions of years. And according to Hindu theology, we're in one of the many different creations of many, many infinite, even, universes. But don't worry, we're only about 3/4 of the way through. We have millions of more years to go. Just in case you were nervous. But the notion is that Brahma creates this universe, and then for some very extended period of time, Vishnu preserves it. And there are periods when the universe falls into decline. In many translations, it will say the universe became darkened with concern for material goods, materiality. And Vishnu has to send in an avatar. This is a word that's become more and more popular in English. You know, people use it on their computers. When you play a game, you have an avatar of who you are, or you, you know, if you have a Facebook page, you have an avatar picture of you or something. Right? An avatar is a material stand-in for the god. So Vishnu would send a material stand-in, an avatar, in order to save the world. And this would happen again and again and again. And there are a number of different traditions about Vishnu's various avatars. One is a fish, one is a turtle. I might not get all of them off the top of my head. Fish, turtle, I believe there's a lion, there's a monkey, there is there's a human being. And each of these in different ways saves the world. In traditional Hinduism, there are 7 avatars of Vishnu, the last one being Krishna. Krishna, who appeared in the form of a human being, and the story of Krishna is told in the very famous text that tells about the conversation between the prince Arjuna and the god Vishnu in human form, and that text is called the Bhagavad Gita. The Bhagavad Gita, sometimes just referred to as the Gita. And that text itself is actually a small snippet. It's actually a pretty thick book of some 120 or 50 pages, depending on how you translate it. But that text itself is a small snippet of a much larger epic called the Mahabharata. I'm not going to spell it out. In the text of the Gita, the Bhagavad Gita, we have a very, very fascinating tale that is just beautifully illustrated. It's very visual. And I'll tell you a little bit about it right now. It opens with a battle scene. On one side of the battlefield, you have an army lined up. And on the other side of the battlefield, you have another army lined up. And all of the warriors are ready to go to war, and they're raising their spears, and they're pounding their chests, and they're blowing the conch horns in order to sound the alarm that they're going to go to war, and everybody's ready to kill. And I picture this in sort of the MGM grand cinematic style, like, you know. A widescreen shot of the two sides ready to go, and then you bring in the camera closer and closer and closer, and you go down the line of the one of the armies, and you see how bloodthirsty they all are. And then you come really tight in close shot on Prince Arjuna, who is the leader of one side of the army, and you see in contrast, stark contrast with all of his warriors, he is quiet and sullen. He's in his chariot, and there is a charioteer next to him who is beautiful. And the charioteer happens to be Krishna. And the charioteer and Arjuna go off in the chariot to the middle of the battlefield, the no man's land. And Arjuna looks out upon all of the warriors lined up in his camp, all ready for battle, blowing their horns, pounding their chests. And he looks out on all of the warriors lined up in the enemy's camp, doing the same thing. And he turns to Krishna, and he says, I would rather die than have any one of these noble men on either side killed and have their blood be on my conscience. He says, I see lined up on my side fathers and sons and brothers and teachers. And I see lined up in the enemy's camp fathers and sons and brothers and teachers. And far be it from me to spill blood. For what? For a piece of dirt? For some real estate? No. And in my mind, with the cinema, I see him snapping his spear. That's not in the book, though. When I first read this, I was taken aback. I had heard all sorts of wonderful things about the Bhagavad Gita, what a wonderful spiritual book it is, and so on and so forth. And I was just flabbergasted that an ancient text like this could express such compassion for humanity and see in the enemy that they are just like we are, and that we shouldn't be killing for property or for land or for prestige. And I was just taken aback. The hair on the back of my neck stood up with how wonderful Arjuna is. And I thought to myself, yes, this is a great spiritual man who is also the leader of his people. And then I turned the page, and I got to Krishna's response to Arjuna. And Arjuna is there weeping over the thought of calamity that might happen. And Krishna says to him, not, yes, Arjuna, you have proved yourself to be a valiant and very considerate, thoughtful, and humane individual. That's not what Krishna says. Krishna turns to Arjuna and says, stop being such a woman. That's a quote. Stop your crying and fight. I was like, whoa! That's weird. But then I went on to read that this is not just some sort of praise by the god of war, or for war, and it's not just deriding what we would call today a conscientious objector, but rather, Krishna goes on to explain why Arjuna should go on to fight. It's not that what Arjuna is saying is not important, or that he's weak, or that he is, you know, not brave or something, but rather, Krishna goes on to explain that anyone who thinks that a spear kills the soul, or that fire destroys the spirit, or that water drowns that which is eternal in a human being, is deluded. Krishna goes on to say that this flesh and blood is merely like an actor's clothing. When it gets worn out and full of holes, we don't hold on to it. We toss it off and take new ones. And in the same way, the soul lives on even when the flesh is destroyed. And it takes on new flesh. This is the doctrine of reincarnation that Krishna is trying to teach Arjuna. And since we are to be reincarnated, what we have to do in this life, says Krishna, is we need to live up to our roles in society. And now this is very important for Hindu belief and Hindu tradition, because as you probably know, in India, even still today, even though it's outlawed by the formal laws of India, there is a caste system. The Brahmins, the priestly caste, are on the top. Then there are the kings and warriors. Then there are the merchants. And then there are the people who work in the fields, the people who toil at agriculture. And then lastly, there are the untouchables. And what Krishna is trying to teach Arjuna is that it does not matter what your role in life is. What matters is that you live up to that role. So Arjuna, you are a prince and a leader of this army. You have to do what the role demands of you. And so on down the line. We each have our role to fulfill. Now, what happens in terms of this notion of reincarnation is that if we fulfill our role properly, we build up what's called good karma. So we're introducing another new term. Karma, Sanskrit word, became popular in the late 60s and early 70s, such songs as Instant Karma. Karma means literally action. Action. Karma is the actions that you do. Another way of translating it is deed. It's the deeds that you do. And depending on the deed, you can accumulate either good karma or bad karma. Now, I'm not sure how the mechanism is supposed to work, right? It's some sort of cosmic accountant that happens, and I'm not sure where the accountant is or who the accountant is. That's never explained. But karma is reckoned somewhere as either good or bad. And if you have good karma, if you've earned good karma, then in that next life, you will be born into some better status. So if you are part of the agrarian class this life, then maybe in the next life you'll be part of the warrior class. And if you do your job as a warrior in this life, maybe in the next life you'll even be a Brahmin. And it's not just limited to human beings. Supposedly, if your karma is bad enough, maybe you'll be born as a lobster. And supposedly, if the lobster is good enough, maybe the lobster will be a sea bass. I'm not sure. I don't really know how it works. And if I did, and if we all did, maybe we'd be a lot better off. But that's the notion of it, is that there's good karma, bad karma. Depending on your actions, there is some sort of reward. It's not an otherworldly reward. It's a later worldly reward. Because sometime later, after you die, you'll be reborn as something else. So this is the doctrine that Krishna is trying to teach to Arjuna in the middle of the battlefield. But he goes on. And that's not simply the end of the story. Because Krishna goes on to explain lots of other mysteries to Arjuna. Mainly because Arjuna is very curious and asks a lot of questions. The whole book reads as a dialogue between the two of them. That's where the whole cinematography just breaks down, because then it would just be, he said, she said, right? Arjuna asks about being able to know Krishna. And it's couched in some very difficult language, but in this little dialogue, we get the entire understanding of the Upanishadic view of the world. And this has to do with the question of the one and the many. So now, I'm going to make a crude comparison with some notions in the West so that we might get a better sense of things. Vishnu, we said, is what?
God of preservation.
God of preservation. At least you had God. Vishnu, we don't come in direct contact with Vishnu. Vishnu sends an avatar, right? The flesh and blood image of Vishnu, and that could appear as a turtle or as a monkey or as a lion or something. In this case, it appears as a man, as Krishna. And that would be sort of like, to make a rough analogy, between God the Father, who is not seen, and God the Son, Jesus, walking on the earth. But what Krishna goes on to explain is that that's not the end of the story. That beyond the three personifications, or the three anthropomorphisms, or the three aspects of Brahma, creation deity, Vishnu, preservation deity, and Shiva, destruction deity, that these are really three aspects of one. And that one is called Brahman, with an N at the end. B-R-A-H-M-A-N. Brahman. Brahman is the supreme deity. Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva are merely aspects or different perspectives on Brahman. But now, this is where it's going to take a real difficult turn for us. Brahman is a god that has no attributes, has no qualities. Brahman is a god that has no attributes, no qualities. Now, I need to explain that a little bit better. I see some puzzled looks. Everything that we see, hear, taste, touch, smell, or think has attributes or qualities, right? Let's take this podium, for instance. So this is an experiment you at home can do. And I'm going to ask you all to do that now here as well. This is where I usually lose my 8:30 class, because I mistakenly ask them to close their eyes. But sometimes when I lose the entire class, it's not so bad, because I can just tiptoe out, and I get like a half a day. I'm going to ask you not to fall asleep. Only because the snoring will affect the sound for the people at home. Take a close look at this podium here. Take a good observation of it. You all see it? You all see that it has a certain height, depth, width, certain color, certain hardness to it. If I was to lick it, which I won't do, it'd have a certain taste, it has a certain feel, probably has a certain smell to it. Okay. Now, what I want you to do is, without falling asleep, I want you to close your eyes. Okay. Now picture the podium in your mind's eye. See how tall it is, how thick it is, how wide it is. See how colorful it is. You all got that? Now, one by one, I want you to strip away or peel away one aspect of it. So let's start with peeling away its color. Just peel off that color. Great. Now peel off its height, its width, its depth, its weight, its hardness or softness. Peel off what it feels like. Peel off what it smells like. Peel off what it tastes like. Peel off all of those things, and now, what are you left with?
Nothing.
Okay, you may open your eyes now. Anybody whose eyes are still shut, I'm going to ask the person next to you to poke you in the stomach. That's a really, really hard thought experiment to do, because If you take away every quality about it, its weight, its look, its texture, if you take away the qualities that it could burn up or that it could be written on or something like that, you, technically speaking, can't even think it. You can't think it. And now Krishna tells Arjuna that Brahman, the supreme deity, is like that. Has no attributes, has no qualities. So to say that Brahman is a deity, well, guess what? A deity is
nothing.
No, to say a deity, that is already giving it an attribute or a quality. To say that Brahman is supreme is to give it an attribute or a quality. If we say that Brahman is the supreme deity, we have just told a lie. Right? But because our minds are so limited in the way that we can think, that's the only way we can express it, or perhaps one of a few ways that we can express it. Let's think about this again for a moment. Brahman is the supreme deity who has no characteristics, no attributes at all. But if Brahman has no characteristics or attributes, Brahman cannot be either supreme or a deity. And this points to the central paradox of not only Hinduism, but as we'll see, many, many different religions. The paradox being that we don't have a way of properly speaking about this God. If we say Brahman is a supreme deity, one way of speaking about it is to say that we spoke falsely, we spoke incorrectly, or we spoke inaccurately. Another way of saying about it is we spoke metaphorically or mythologically. In other words, we can't properly speak about it, so we need to speak about it improperly. And one of the ways of speaking about it improperly is to tell myths. And so I'm going to steal directly from Joseph Campbell. Joseph Campbell suggests, actually Alan Watts, I think, suggested this, that the myths of Hinduism are so preposterously outrageous, not because people believe them, like, oh, they're so silly back then, they believed all this crazy stuff. Rather, they're so preposterously outrageous to ensure that nobody would believe them. Because if you believe the stories about the gods, then you have fallen into believing all these attributes and qualities, which are not the gods. So they would tell the stories in a way that would be outrageously fantastical in order to get at something that was somewhat like the god. It's an analogical thinking, you might say, instead of logical. And so we have many, many different stories, and I'm going to tell you one before our time is up. I'm going to tell you one of my favorites. But we need to get to the next part of this. And the next part is the central thesis, not only of the Bhagavad Gita, but of all the Upanishads. All the Upanishads are in some way reflecting on this next phrase. The phrase is Atman Brahman. And I'll spell that for you. A-T-M-A-N, all one word. Atman Brahman, B-R-A-H-M-A-N. And you might, if it helps you, put an equal sign between the two. What is Atman? Atman is the Sanskrit word for self. And the central thesis is that you, yourself, are Brahman. Another way of saying it in Sanskrit is Tatvamasi. I'll say that again. Ta tvam asi. T-A-T, one word. Tvam, T-V-A-M. Asi, A-S-I. Ta means that. Tvam means thou or you. And asi means are. And it translates as, thou art that. You are that. And the that here is Brahma. Now, that might not make sense to you. You might be sitting there thinking, how am I Brahman, the supreme deity? Right? I thought I knew who I was coming into this lecture. How many of you thought that? Raise your hand. Okay, you sir in the cap. Can I use you as a victim? I mean, volunteer. Sorry, I do that all the time.
Sure.
May I? Okay, great. Have we met before?
No.
Never?
Never.
Okay, good. So we didn't rehearse this. We didn't rehearse this beforehand.
No.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I didn't give you any cue cards.
No.
Okay, good. So, I'm going to ask you one very simple question, and I want you to answer it as best you can. Who are you?
I am Reuven Tola.
Excuse me? I didn't catch that.
Well, my name.
Lou. Lou. Lou, I appreciate that. It's a noble effort. I didn't ask your name. If I wanted to know your name, I'd say, what's your name? I asked, who are you?
A tough one. I mean,
so we
combination of a physical and spiritual being.
You're a what?
A combination of a physical and spiritual.
A combination of a physical. Wow.
Mental, emotional.
Okay, that's really complex. Can you give me something a little more simple there? Remember, we got the people at home to think about tonight. You know, they haven't had the preparatory courses. So, how would you answer that?
I don't know. I'm stumped. I mean,
you're stumped already. One question and I stumped the audience. I mean, a lot of people might say, well, this is my name. My name is Lou. A lot of people might say, well, I live here in Acton, but I didn't ask where you live. They might say, well, I'm retired. I would say, I didn't ask your profession. They'd say, well, I'm a father of three. I didn't ask anything about your family, right? And you can go on and on and on. And every answer that you give is answering a different question besides who are you, right? Every answer you give answers a different question other than who are you, right? I'm a human being. I didn't ask your genus and species, right?
I am that I am.
I am that I am. That's all that I am. I'm Popeye the Sailor. The notion here is that if you really try to ask yourself, who am I? The only thing that we can answer, the only way we can answer is in characteristics and attributes. Or relations, our relations to other things, our family, our job, our place of residence, right? But if you ask essentially, meaning what it is to be you, we come up with nothing. And this is the key insight of the Upanishads, that you are essentially, meaning what it is to be you, no different from Brahman. Everything else that you thought you knew about you, how old you are, your relationship to other people, your job, and so on and so forth, all of that is merely relational stuff, right? If I ask you what a box is, and you say, well, it's kind of like a triangle, but it has more sides, Right? Or if I ask you what a square is, you say it's kind of like a triangle, but it has one more side. And it's kind of like a pentagon, but it has one less side, right? You haven't told me what a square is. You've only told me about it in relation to other things. Now, with a square, we can say what it is essentially. It's a four-sided closed figure that has all four sides being equal, and they meet at corners that are 90 degrees on the interior angle. That's very easy. But for you, what, or not what, but who are you, that is more difficult. And the notion, the central notion of the Upanishads is that you are Brahman. Brahman is you. Tat Vamasi. Thou art that. And not only are you that, but everything is that. What do I mean by everything? Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva, those are all Brahman. Krishna is Brahman. You are Brahman. All of humanity is Brahman. All of the animal world and plant world and inert objects are Brahman. It's all Brahman. And another way of saying that is, it's all one. And that's what I was getting at when I said the central question of these philosophers is the relationship of the one and the many. Brahman as one, our experience of the world as many. Now, the question you may have is, well, if that's the case, why do I experience the world as many, as having all sorts of different things in it from different people? Why do I experience it in a pluralistic way? And the Upanishads have an answer for you. The answer is Maya. Maya, M-A-Y-A. Maya means divine illusion.
Divine illusion.
Divine illusion. Maya is divine illusion. In other words, the reason why you experience you as separate from anybody else here and separate from the chair you're sitting on and separate from Brahman is because of this illusion. Now, we need to have a better understanding of what that means. Brahman and illusion. Okay? So, you did a thought experiment before. I am now going to perform a magic trick for you. Okay? You didn't, Chris, you didn't know you hired a magician, did you? For this magic trick, I want you to make sure you get this. I'm going to roll up my sleeve, as I don't want you to think that I have anything up my sleeve. Okay. Now, I need you all to watch very carefully. Watch my right hand. You got that? Get it close up, because I don't want you to think that there's any smoke and mirrors happening. Because when you're at home, you think, that would just happen because, you know, special effects, they stop the camera. I'm not going to do that. You all can attest that you saw this. You ready?
Okay.
So, do you see this? Everybody sees this? Am I right? What is it?
A fist.
A fist. Everybody got that?
Yeah.
Everybody see it clearly?
Yeah.
People in the back see?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I want you to watch it very carefully. I want you to focus on it. And then, all together, I want you to count to three and watch what happens on three really carefully. Ready?
One, two, three.
What do I have here now?
A hand.
Where'd the fist go? Huh? See? Where'd the fist go?
It's a different form of the hand.
Ah. The fist has disappeared. Thank you. Thank you. Now, where, if the fist has disappeared, where was the fist? Where did it exist?
In your hand.
No, it didn't exist in my hand. Not in my head. In your head. The fist only existed in your head because you use language, and language makes a distinction between a fist and a hand. And that, my friends, is Maya. And let me explain why I say that is Maya. Maya is a word that is related to all sorts of English and Latin words. Maya is related to the word month. In Latin, there would be mens, M-E-N-S, which is related to the word menstrual, right, having to do with the month. All of that is related to mental, M-E-N-T-A-L, and measure, and meter, and metric. Now, what do all of these words have in common? Measure, meter, metric, month, mens. And by the way, the word mens in Latin also, it's like a homonym. Mens also means thought, as in, if anybody is a lawyer here, the term mens rea, right? To have thought, premeditated thought about a crime. So what do all those words have in common?
Measurement of time and space.
Measurement. They all measure stuff. And they all come from the word Maya in Sanskrit, which means illusion. Now, let's think more carefully about that. If I said that in downtown Acton, it is the 37th parallel of latitude, and we all went on a field trip to downtown Acton to find the 37th parallel of latitude, would we trip over it?
No.
No, we wouldn't. Would we see it, even with a magnifying glass?
No.
No, we wouldn't. So where does it exist?
In our minds.
Now let's think about this for a moment. The Hindus say that Maya is divine illusion. Divine illusion means it's an illusion, yes, but it can be really important. Right? Why? Because it's by the lines of latitude and longitude that don't really exist. Right? It's a collective delusion that we believe in them. But that's how we fly from New York to Paris. Really, really helpful illusions. Right? Or maybe for you. I love thinking about this one. I used to live in the suburbs. And one day, I'm driving with my kids down a suburban street. And it was like a Sunday, and people were out mowing the lawn. And my daughter says, "Dad, how do they know where their property ends, or where their yard ends, and the next yard begins?" And I said, "Because of the property line." And she said, naively of course, "I don't see a line. How do they know where it is?" Right? And that's exactly the point, right? There is a property line, but where does it exist? It only exists in your mind and the neighbor's mind, right? And you bring out a surveyor to like maybe tell you where it is, but this is all a collective illusion. Now, probably with some of you, you're like, "No, my neighbor's delusional. My property line goes 3 feet further than where he's mowing." But the point being, these are not reality. These are illusions. But they're very, very helpful illusions, right? Because if I say that I went to a bar and Lou punched me in the face with his hand, that would be very different from I went to a bar and Lou punched me in the face with his fist. Right? That might make a big difference. So, fist, hand. We make these distinctions. They're not real. They're illusions. They're in our minds. But they're important. To give you a Hindu story that exemplifies this importance of the illusions is, There was a guru who had a pupil.
He had a what?
A pupil, a student. And the guru was pontificating about how everything is God, everything is Brahma. It's all Brahma, it's all God. The student was really trying to get this thought and really wasn't getting it. And then one day, the student's walking through a very busy downtown street in India, when suddenly, like a switch goes off, and he finally gets it. He finally understands. It's all God. And he's standing there in this sudden moment of bliss at this epiphany that just came to him. But unfortunately, there was a trader riding on an elephant coming right towards him. And the elephant rider was yelling, "Get out of the way, get out of the way!" But the student was just so overwhelmed with this vision of the oneness of everything that the elephant got right up to him, wrapped its trunk around him, picked him up physically, and tossed him off, and he went rolling into the shrubs. He comes out, he climbs up the mountain to his guru, to the crutch, broken leg, bandages all over, and the guru says, "What happened to you?" And the student says, "Well, I finally got it. I finally understood. Everything is gone." And the guru says, "But that doesn't explain what happened to you." And the student says, "Well, it happened to me that I understood this in the middle of a busy intersection. And an elephant came up to me and picked me up and tossed me to the side. And I broke my leg and I got all these bruises." And the guru said, "Did the elephant rider try to warn you?" And the student says, "Yes, he was yelling, 'Watch out, get out of the way, move it, get out of the way.'" And the guru says to him, "Well, you know, sometimes it's good to listen to God." So, now, we're ready for my last story, which is a creation myth of the Hindus. And in this creation myth, it tells about how Brahman, at the very beginning of creating the world, split into two, into a male and a female. And as male and female, the female side of Brahman wanted to mate and copulate with the male side. And the male side, for whatever reason, kept on running away and trying to disguise himself from the female side. And the first Brahman disguised himself as a little fish. And then the female side turned into a fish and caught up with the male side and copulated with him. And that's how all the fish were born. And then the male side decided to disguise himself as a turtle, and then the female side just changed into a turtle, caught up with him, copulated, and that's how all the amphibious things were created. And then the male side decided to take on the aspect of a lion, and then the female side did the same thing, and then similarly with all the different animals, that's how they were all created. Then finally, the male side took on the disguise of a human being, the female side took on the disguise also of a female human being. They calculated that's how human beings came about. Now, remember I told you that these myths are purposely, completely outrageous. It's not that, you know, somewhere in India, there would be a group of people who are strict creationists and they refer back to this story to tell about how all the things came into being. But rather, it's meant to be a preposterous and humorous tale to explain a key insight. And that key insight here is that Brahman is all things. With that story, I'll open to any of your questions. Yes?
Can we describe Brahman as an attribute, as mystery? Would you use that word?
Can we describe Brahman as mystery is the question. Yes, we can describe Brahman as mystery. Brahman is the ultimate mystery because no matter how much you explain of Brahman, you're not going to get it. Or I could even say, the more you explain of Brahman, the further away from it you get. Or even more, the more you think you know it, the less you do. So it has to remain essentially mysterious.
So that's your word.
Okay. Aren't there those who would say that Brahman is nothing and therefore doesn't exist?
The question is, aren't there those who say that Brahman is nothing and therefore doesn't exist? I'm going to ask you to hold that question till the next time I'm here and I'm discussing Buddhism.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you used several words during your lecture. One was Trinity, and you also transcendentalism. I would call it a concept you borrowed from a lot of this mythology, this Eastern mythology. And what's important to know, those of us probably come from a Judeo-Christian background, is the fact that Eastern religions are based on an idea called pantheism, where they look at reality, look at nature, and it's all one. Creator and nature is all one. In the Western religions, namely Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, they look at it a lot we look at it a lot differently in the West. That there is a creator that creates everything. And everything is a result of this creator. Now, that introduces other problems that have to be dealt with philosophically. One is, now when you use the word Trinity, again, most people from a Judeo-Christian background, they say Trinity, they're only familiar with the Christian idea of Trinity. They're not the same, they're entirely different concepts with a chasm of difference between the two, as much as Isis and Horus is different from the Virgin Mary and Christ. They're totally two different concepts. The ones you spoke about are very, very primitive ideas. Very primitive ideas, and like our own Western Bible, you can make anything you want of it. You can defend any concept you want, because there's so much written in there, all you have to do is lift passages that will support whichever theology you want to fabricate. I think it's an important thing to stress between the ideas of the thought process of the East with Western thought. One is a creator, who, in fact the word nature, who creates nature comes from the Latin word naturum, to be born, to have a beginning, an origin. In the East, it's totally different. It's an unending process.
Well, I'd hold on to that thought until my fifth lecture, where I'm going to be explicitly comparing and contrasting East and West. And I would agree with almost all that you said. The one thing that I would nuance a little bit is, rather than saying primitive, I would say archaic. Right? Archaic meaning the beginning of something. Primitive seems to have a derogatory sense to it, like meaning that it's not as advanced or as complex. I would just say that it's archaic, meaning it's very old. But I would not say that it's primitive in the sense of being not advanced or not complex.
They come from a non-scientific age. They come from a non-scientific age. Therefore, the formulas, the concepts, interpretations have to be from people who, like you asked a question to Lou over there, who are you? I think if you took the Cartesian approach, it would have been very accurate to say, cogito ergo sum, I am, therefore I exist. But how do you just, you're the sum total of all your experiences. So the answer that Luke was giving you is, he is the sum total of all his experience. This identifies him as an individual, a human being, who doesn't reincarnate, he doesn't recycle himself, you know, like
well, these people. They definitely were a pre-scientific age, if by scientific we mean, you know, the science that grew out of the Enlightenment. But that also, that doesn't exclude the fact that what they're trying to get at is something different from an empirical truth. Because there's different kinds of truths. And I talk about this in my Principles of World Religions lecture. That there's an empirical truth that you can gain by observation. And then there's different kinds of truths, such as when we speak of the truth contained in Moby Dick, right? All fiction is a series of lies strung together and meant to be believed. But it contains a giant truth. So that's very different. If we go searching for Moby Dick, we leave from Boston Harbor to find the white whale, it's going to be fruitless, and we might say, oh, that's a lot of hogwash, there's no truth in that book whatsoever. But we've completely missed the point. Other questions? Yes?
If I remember one of your earlier lectures with Buddhism and with Western religions, there are historical personages or identified personages who developed the religion.
Mm-hmm.
In Hinduism, are there the equivalent of prophets or teachers who developed the Hinduism, or did it just kind of grow organically?
In the Upanishads, there's lots and lots of named teachers. I mean, they give first names of teachers and first names of students, or at least some sort of title that identifies who the teacher and the student are. But we, so far as I can tell, there's no personages that we can identify historically. Yes?
You were talking earlier about karma and getting the good points and the bad points, but that in itself has an attribute, and who is making the judgment?
That's a great question. The question is, earlier I was talking about karma, good karma and bad karma, and that in itself has an attribute, and who's making the judgment about this? Wow. Put your finger right on it. That is crucial, because when I was talking about the early chapters of the Bhagavad Gita and Krishna saying, we all have a role we have to play, play your role. By the end of the book, what we realize is karma, these roles, all of it is Maya. It's a divine illusion. And as I try to stress, that doesn't mean it's an unimportant illusion. Because especially for the people who wrote these texts, I would imagine, and for the audiences who listen to them, the structure of society was crucial. Maintaining these roles was integral to keeping society going. But it's sort of introductory to have this notion of reward and punishment, right? It's not, as I said, it's not an otherworldly reward and punishment. It's a reincarnated reward and punishment, but it's still, right, it's still the game that you play with kindergarteners and first graders. If you all do what you're supposed to do, we'll get a pizza party. And if you don't, well, that means no recess, right? It's behavior modification. By the end of the book, we realize that's really good for the people who aren't ready to understand what Maya is, and that they are Brahma, that they have short-circuited, you might say, the entire karmic process. When you realize Atman Brahma, I am Brahma, there's no more lives to wait for. And that's one major thing that I didn't talk about. How could you let me get away with that? I didn't mention Nirvana. Right? Nirvana breaks the cycle of birth and death and rebirth. And it breaks the cycle by breaking this cosmic karmic chain. Nirvana means blowing the candle out. It means literally to blow out or to exhale. The way I try to bring this to my students in a very visceral way is I say, okay, clear off your desks, take out a pencil and a piece of paper, and they immediately... And then I say, you know, they're like, we didn't know that there was a quiz today. And then I say, there is no quiz, and then you hear, whew. That, the whew, is Nirvana. Right? It's the release. Right? What are we constantly doing in life? We're sucking it in. We're trying to get it, trying to keep it. But Nirvana is the letting go. Right? Alan Watts loves to quote from the New Testament in explaining Nirvana. Right? New Testament, he who holds on to his own life will lose it, but he who lets go of his life will keep it. That notion of letting go, because you are Brahma, right? There's nothing to worry about. All these forms, all these different permutations are going to fade away Shiva is ultimately going to be victorious, but it's okay, because it's all illusion. Yeah.
If all of this is illusion, does that mean that there's no significance to anyone?
The question is, if this is all illusion, does that mean that there is no significance to anyone? Yes and no. Yes, in that it is all an illusion. No, in that it is all an illusion. Right? I mean, that's like asking, is that elephant that picked up the student insignificant? No, it's not insignificant. But on the other hand, it is also God. Right? And so there's always this dual perspective. And it reminds me of those optical illusions where you can't tell if the box is going this way or going that way, or the, you know, whether it's an old woman or a young woman, yeah? And you try to look at it at both ways simultaneously and you just can't do it. And so you either err on the side of one or you err on the side of many. But trying to have the dual perspective of one and many is really difficult. Yes?
Is not illusion Brahman, if I think it's...
Oh, wow. Wow.
What was the question?
The question is not illusion Brahman if everything is Brahman? Mm-hmm. Joseph Campbell, the great, great writer, he was interviewed by Bill Moyers in the Power of Myth series back in the late 80s, I believe. And you can get it, I'm sure, at your local library. He's written extraordinary books. He tells a story about going to India, and he comes to this ashram, this school, where a guru is teaching about Brahman and about Maya and about all this. And he gets there, and the teacher, the guru, asks, how do we explain Maya, illusion, and Brahman? How is it that there's both Maya and Brahman? And all the students are dumbfounded, they're perplexed. And Campbell says, well, if Brahman is everything, isn't Brahman also Maya? And the guru scolds his student, and he says, why does it take a Westerner to come here and tell you that? Exactly, yes. Maya is Brahman. Or one way of another way that the Upanishads phrase it is, Maya is the Lila of Brahma. Lila is the Sanskrit word for play. Maya is the Lila of Brahma. It's all the play. I mean, a lot of Upanishads will say the dream of Brahma, that Brahman is dreaming, right? And you are Brahman, right? So you are Brahman, you're the one dreaming. And then you wonder, you ask yourself, well, why do all these horrible things always happen? Why are there always calamities and bad things? And not only to other people, like tsunamis and things, why do bad things happen to me? Right? And Alan Watts has a great story in an essay called The Drama of It All. He says, you know, if you could have a lucid dream every night, right, you would have these wonderful dreams all the time. But after a few, I don't know, 1,000 dreams, you might get bored. And so then you'd be like, well, let's have a dream about a roller coaster. Let's have a dream about a monster. Let's have a dream about, you know, Jack Nicholson in The Shining. Right? So then you might start doing that. But after a while, even that would become boring because you know you're in control of the dream. It's a lucid dream. You're in control of it. And so then you might be hoping that when you go to sleep at night, that there'd be like a button that you could press. And the button's called Surprise Me. So you go to sleep and you press the button, Surprise Me. Right? And so that's when you forget that you're the dreamer dreaming. And that the dream is no longer lucid. And it seems not only real and frightening and scary and horrible, but it seems like it's not in your control at all. And then, if it gets really frightening and scary, what will you try to do? You want to try to find your way back. And so, what happens? That's when you start studying Hinduism. You become a guru to realize, I think I'm going to hold all your questions until next week, because I have no idea how much time you're allotted, and I haven't showed you went over. So I will see you, if not next week, the next session, which I'm not sure when it is. I think it's next month sometime. Is it next month or next week?
No, it's next week. I think it's 20. There are two this month, I think.
Two this month? Okay. I will see you then, and we'll talk about Buddhism. Thank you very much.
You have
I have it on my hand.